And good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed a pleasure and an honor to be the moderator for the second panel discussion at EQ conference. The topic that we will be discussing is related to financing, both debt as well as equity for solar projects in India. And I'll introduce everybody on the panel. What we will stick to the first panel format, where we will allow everybody to speak for a few minutes. And we'll follow that with some questions that I will pose to all the gentlemen on the panel. So I'll just give some background on the financing part for renewables. Now, solar of course has come a long way in terms of acceptance in the financing community, both in terms of debt as well as equity. Now we have several years of successful commissioning of projects. On the solar side, we have several years of performance data. So there is a lot of comfort in the lending community now in terms of acceptance of technologies. Last 2-3 years, ever since this government came into power, there has been a very clear vision provided to the entire industry, which was missing 5 years earlier. So we've seen 10,000 plus megawatts commissioned in the last year. And at least in the current pipeline, we see similar capacity to be commissioned over the next 12 months. In terms of debt financing, one of the important things that we have seen is that from project finance, several developers on the renewable side have now progressed on to bond financing. So once you aggregate a portfolio, say of 500 megawatts operating capacity or more, several of these developers are able to take advantage of lower costs as well as fixing the interest rate over a medium term. So that's a positive part that we have seen, which is being taken advantage of by the larger developers. On the equity side, what we've seen is now for some reason, some of the larger utilities in the country, not all of them have been present in the solar space. Because largely still solar used to be smaller in terms of capacity, 100 megawatts, 200 megawatts at a certain place, as opposed to thermal where they could do 1200 megawatts, 1500 megawatts in a certain place. So, but apart from them, a lot of the projects have been largely financial investors dominated. So we have now some of the largest portfolios players in the country today are dominated by financial investors. Largely foreign ownership. We continue to see a lot of capital chasing renewable in the country. In fact, probably more capital chasing than projects available. And that has its own implications, which the country is seeing. Be that as it may, I think over the next maybe medium term, 3 to 5 years, we continue to see an addition of a good amount of capacity year on year. And I think now the market is also moving to some monetization events. There is a subject of deal flow for the next for the next year. And as part of ENY, we are well placed. So we are seeing several portfolios are in the market for sale, 100% sale. And we will see some large transactions that will take place. Some have taken place already, and more are going to take place over the next 12 to 18 months. So with this, I would now like to invite all the panelists for a discussion. Maybe I'll start with Alipt sitting on my left. Alipt, why don't you want to speak about some of the financing aspects in solar?
Hi, I'm Alipt Sharma from GES Capital. We've been global clean technology resource efficiency investors for the last 30 odd years. We've had a fairly strong presence in India. We're slightly differentiated. We probably come in earlier than some of the larger pools of capital. Some of the platforms that we've backed in India on the asset heavy side have included Greenco and Renew. And we continue to see as Sweta mentioned, a lot of deal flow in platforms focusing on both grid connected and distributed solar, and maybe to a lesser extent on the wind side, given the ease of deployment of solar. I think from a macro perspective, globally, we believe that renewable is the way to go. So business models will change. They will kind of adapt to the regime in force. But as a source of energy, renewable will always have a place. In India, we I think the medium-term outlook, long-term outlook for us remains positive. I think as investors, what we need to do is basically back the right management team, look at a platform that will scale, and keep enough headroom in our base case financial models to maybe take care of whatever contingencies may arise on account of duty structure changes or module price fluctuation. So we don't really see those really as concern areas. Those are basically aspects that a sound financial model will take care of. Essentially, as an investor, what we're looking to back is a sound management team that will be able to create a platform that is scalable. We may have been lucky, but we've been, I think, have had a fairly good experience in India, given that we backed two of the most scaled platforms on the private sector side.
Thanks, Shweta. Let me introduce myself. I'm Vivek Nigam, and I come from HDFC Bank. And I'm part of the investment banking team, and within the investment banking team, I head the project finance function, and PAR is one of the areas that we have been active in. A lot of people, I'm sure, who are sitting here would come with the assumption that HDFC Bank does not get into long-term financing, and to that, let me give you a data point. In the last year, in the last 12 months, we have done about 12 renewable projects, and all of them are pretty much in the long-term space. Now, coming back to looking into the future, I believe that we, being the largest private sector bank in the country today, will be lending our balance sheet to viable projects, and we will continue to grow quite aggressively in this sector. Now, coming back to the topic of discussion here, I think there's been a lot of discussion in terms of the opportunities in solar space and renewable space, and also a lot of viewpoints have been given on the challenges, and I'm sure that each one of us is aware of the challenges here. But I would like to focus my discussion, my talk on the challenges and in the financing space. And I personally believe that we have had a good run till now, but the coming year is going to be extremely challenging for developers in terms of tying up financing on the debt side. And that's something which is which every developer would need to take into account. Because we are seeing very abnormal kind of market conditions where the entire banking market has really shrunk in size. We have very, very few banks which are active in the space, and we have a few NBFCs which are active in the space. While the market has shrunk, on the other side, the supply side is extremely, extremely buoyant. So you have so many projects which are coming to the market, but if you really ask me, one key challenge that people will face will not be in terms of accessing cheap financing. It's going to be accessing financing in the first place, and therefore it will be extremely important to take that into account when developers are bidding for these projects. In the subsequent sessions, maybe I can give some of my views in terms of what will need to be done. But that's going to be a key theme. Banks, the second part is that despite having such a strong pipeline of projects, what we are seeing in the successive bidding is extremely low tariffs. And that's a little counterintuitive, because at the end of the day, if you have such a strong pipeline of projects which are being bid out, with these kind of tariffs, I'm sure that banks still need to be convinced about the viability of these projects. So unless and until that conviction comes back in the banking sector, I see that is going to be a critical element. So with that, I would like to just pass it on to the next panelist.
Thank you, Vivek, for your valuable inputs on the from that provider perspective. I would now like to invite Mr. Jayan Gaukar to share his valuable insights with respect to what he's seeing in the financing scenario for renewables.
Hi, I'm Jayan Gaukar, representing the wholesale business vertical for L&T Financial Services. L&T Financial Services, as a partner to solar industry, the journey began right from 2011-12 onwards. We were a small sized NBFC at that point of time, having a limited wholesale book, where we found an excellent opportunity to fund small size solar projects. At that time, 5 MW, 10 MW was the size of the projects then. And around 2012-13, that became a very much a focus area, and right now a very dominant part of our wholesale book. As a journey, we first arrived at a framework with which we would like to lend to any upcoming project. Considering the short gestation of these solar projects and tight PPA timelines, two things were absolutely not negotiable and were stipulated upfront. One was the equity portion. We had to be convinced that money had to come in before we stepped into the shoes as a lender. And second was, of course, the land part. These two framework-driven decisions actually has held us in good stead, and touch wood, most of the projects or almost all of the projects that we have funded have successfully commissioned and are currently viable. One of the learnings that we have got, or trends that we have seen over last 4-5 years, is that the spread between what an equity investor used to get say 5 years back and what a debt investor used to get 5 years back has now significantly narrowed. So that itself creates a sort of a doubt in the lender's mind whether any sort of an unforeseen circumstance in a project, would the equity investor support the project through its downtime and take it forward. So from a pure play project financing viewpoint of a solar project, gradually we have to move towards sort of a corporate backed project financing structure. So that has been the learning. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Jayan. So L&T, of course, has been a very active financier of renewable projects, and they have been doing it very, very successfully. So his inputs are very valuable. I would now like to request Mr. Sabyasachi Majumdar. He is Vice President at Credit Rating ICRA, to share his inputs on the sector with us.
Thanks. I represent ICRA Limited. We are credit rating agency. We are a listed company and also majority owned by Moody's Corporation, which is the world's oldest and the largest rating agencies. So as I see from the solar, looking upon the debt and equity financing perspective, now one of the good things that I see from the debt perspective is that over the last year, in many ways, the risks have come down. So typically, what is the risks that, let's say, a lender takes, what can go wrong from the lender's perspective if he takes exposure to the solar power project? One is, and this factor is also very similar to what can, let's say, go wrong for others like thermal, hydro, or wind. But in many ways, I see solar as much more superior with respect to certain parameters compared to others from the lender's perspective. Firstly, when does the lender typically make his first disbursement to the solar project? Now, for example, just to draw equivalence from the thermal, I mean, in 2009-10, lots of private sector projects got financing closure. Now, those projects anyway expected to be completed over a 4 to 5 year period, because that's how a project works. There were certain assumptions on various things like offtake, coal prices, and other things. And during the course of those 5 years, a lot of things changed. The projects which seemed very viable became unviable somewhere during the course of execution. Now, that kind of risk does not really exist in the case of solar power projects, because the execution period of the solar power project itself is very small. I mean, from the time you start making the large, you know, utilizations of fund, that is basically you start acquiring the modules and other things. I mean, typically what happens is you have a 70-30 debt equity ratio, and the 30% equity typically comes upfront in most cases, and that is the money which typically goes into acquisition of land, various pre-execution activities. And most of the solar capex which happens, I mean hard cost like equipment cost and other things, typically what we are seeing is that most of these are funded through 1 to 3 year kind of suppliers credit from the equipment provider side. So when the bank typically writes down the first 1 crore check or whatever to the project, the chances are the project is almost ready or about to get ready, or at least the project costs are firm. For instance, let's suppose this 2 rupee 45 paisa projects will come up for financing. So when the lender will actually disburse the first check to these projects, they will more or less have a very good idea as to whether with all the GST, all the anti-dumping duty and whatever, the final project cost is practically known to them. So the chances that at that point of time anything will go wrong is quite less actually for us. Secondly, you know, incrementally as the tariffs are coming down lower and lower, the chances that any off-taker will default on, let's say, of a project which offers a tariff of less than 4 rupees is relatively very low compared to, let's say, older projects where, you know, feed-in tariffs are there, 5 rupees. So you always wonder whether the DISCOM will pay up or not. Incrementally, a lot of these new exposures will come. This kind of risk will not be there. The main risk that will be there from the backer's perspective is the developer using equipment which really can generate power, because typically, as we see, typically you begin with a project financing over at least 12 to 13 years, and then 2 to 3 years down the line when the project shows steady cash flow, you replace with a longer debt or term loan financing of more than 15 to 20 years. So that is, I think, the main focus now on lenders as to whether the developer is using the right kind of equipment and whether he has the right O&M practices. So this is from the debt side. This is my perspective, which I thought I'll share. On the equity, I think with the kind of tariffs which are being seen in the market, I mean, all the developers we speak to, they say they are getting double-digit kind of equity return. But frankly speaking, from all the Excel model, whatever, you know, a benefit of doubt or whatever we can give to the tariffs and the cost assumptions, we are unable to get anything more than the high single digit or very low double digit equity IRR, which means that this is now going to be a game for only big boys. We will not expect, let's say, a medium-sized industrial group with, let's say, 50 or 100 or 200 crore or even 500,000 crore net worth to be willing to, fund large projects, because now the project sizes itself will be 250 megawatt plus. So I think it will now be a very big boys game, possibly international private equity, a few very large developers based out of India or abroad. So it will be a different game from the equity perspective. And for smaller players, they will not be competitive in the large grid connected projects. Probably they will have to find a niche in value-added areas like rooftop or, let's say, combining solar energy with energy efficiency, those kind of markets. So that's what I would
say. Very interesting inputs coming in from Sabyasachi. Thank you very much for sharing those. I would now like to invite the last but not least panelist, Mr. Rahul Agrawal, who is from ACTIS. And ACTIS, you know, as some of you may be aware, has been very, very successful in raising a large platform on both solar as well as wind side. Over to you, Rahul.
Thank you, Shweta. Good morning, everyone. So I'll just keep my opening remarks to four key areas. What is ACTIS for some of you who may not know us? What are we doing in the renewable side in India? And what we like about the solar sector and what we think are the areas where there can be some improvements made. So just a quick one, ACTIS is a global emerging market focused private equity fund. We only invest in emerging markets. We currently manage about $8 billion of assets. About four of that is in the energy side, and energy means power generation and power distribution for us. So we have been very actively investing in Latin America, Africa, and Asia. In Asia, it has been primarily India. We have been large investors in the renewable side since we could see that renewable was coming to grid parity in the last 4-5 years in all our markets. You know, we have currently about 11 platforms in the various regions, all control or majority owned by us. And you know, each having a business plan of 500 to 1,000 megawatt with an equity commitment of about $200 to $300 million minimum. In India, we have set up two platforms. One is Austro Energy, which is an 1,100 megawatt platform today, which has about 110 megawatt of solar, and the balance is wind. The new platform is called Spring Energy, that has 250 megawatt of solar project that they won in Rewa, which is under construction, and we have a 200 megawatt wind project in Gujarat, which is again under construction. In India, between Austro and Spring till date, we have deployed close to $400 million of equity. And in Spring, we have a plan to deploy another $400 million. So with that in context, we do obviously like the sector and we are investors here. What we like about the sector, you know, the PPA quality is becoming better. So earlier we used to have state PPAs, now increasingly we see SECI and NTPC PPAs, the volume of that and as a percentage share of the total market being much higher, which gives comfort to us in terms of an off-taker profile that there is a secure and NTPC in between and not just a final off-taker whom they sell to. SECI, NTPC being state, central government agencies obviously have a better balance sheet, and even the PPA clauses have been structured that the liability is theirs and not passed through to the DISCOMs. The PPAs are long tenor PPAs, 25 years, which is again a positive for getting long-term project financing. The transparent bidding mechanism, which has been there for the last 3-4 years, obviously helps investors like us that there will be no questions asked tomorrow for any of these bids or any of these PPAs. What we now have is solar parks. So the development risk, which generally as equity investors we are averse to, have been taken care of to a large extent, and the solar park volumes are increasing as a percentage of the PPAs. And the third is the volume itself. Now, you know, we are talking about like at least 10 gigawatt of capacities being, 5 to 10 gigawatt of capacities being awarded in the solar sector itself. And I mean, all of you must be aware that yesterday itself, there was about 2000 megawatt of NTPC ISTS tender announced. So that kind of speaks about the volume that this market presents itself, where everybody can kind of get their capacities as and fill their books. What we think can be improved in the sector are basically the factors which as investors we don't like, which is the uncertainty. So like in solar, we want to participate heavily, we like the technology, we like the PPA framework, but this entire uncertainty around anti-dumping duty, safeguard duty, customs duty, GST, we know now what the rules of the game are. But anti-dumping is like, you know, it is like, you know, a project loses 10, you know, a 1,000 bips return if you put the anti-dumping duty as proposed by the lobby, and basically there is no clarity. If we do get a clarity that this is the anti-dumping duty, as financial investors all of us are capable enough to price that in and bid a tariff, but that is not happening, and that basically puts us to risk. Either we bid aggressively and get caught when the anti-dumping duty is put, or we be conservative, do not take the anti-dumping duty, and be left out by losing capacity. So it's a very, you know, it's a very bad situation to be in actually. On the currency, again, you know, while the currency has
you know, reasonably been stable over the last couple of years in India. That is again remains a concern because ultimately we have to return money in dollars. And if something could be done on that front, if a partial indexation or something can be done, that will obviously get more capital in the country. The third is the short construction timelines. I mean, you know, while the Indian supply chain is, you know, much ahead of the, you know, other global supply chain curve, the 12 to 13 month construction timeline does put a lot of pressure on you to acquire land if it is not a solar park project, get evacuation, get construction done. And to do a quality world-class project, I think if there is a 18 to 24 month period which is being provided in some of the projects like Rewa or some other big projects, that really helps you to, you know, make the project better, do a better planning, site layouts, and actually get the generations that you underwrite. So I think these are the comments, but overall we do remain fairly encouraged by the government initiatives. We like the sector. It is one of the largest markets when we compare itself with Mexico, Brazil, Africa, Southeast Asia, India. The kind of volumes that we have, the kind of supply chain that we have, gives us a lot of confidence to invest more money in this sector. Thank you.
Thank you, Rahul, for your inputs coming in as an equity investor as well as a financier of the sector. What we would now do is I have a few questions which I would like to put forth to each of the panelists. And then we would like to throw the floor open to the audience. So, you know, you can then ask your questions also. So I'll ask the first question to Jayant. So Jayant, you know, obviously L&T is a very large participant as a financier in the solar space, especially the recent circulars which have been issued by the RBI in terms of, you know, stopping some practices like LOUs, LOCs, etc. How do you see that impacting availability of debt finance to the renewable sector, since we are speaking of that? And how do you see that impacting the NBFCs versus the banks? You know, if you can give us some views on those.
Yeah. So the downtrend in the tariffs has obviously resulted in pressures on lowering the financing rates. Rupee rates, because of various issues such as provisioning requirements, stress getting built up across various banks, the flexibility to offer extremely low tariffs is still not there. As a as a bypass to that constraint, buyer's credit format of funding has been in vogue, especially in solar, where you import a large part of your project costing in dollar terms. To have a cheap dollar financing for a 3-year period seems to be the most best option available. Now, this sudden change in regulations preventing those LOUs to be issued, which forms the basis of that buyer's credit to be provided, creates a flux of around close to 2 to 2.5% of rate increase in your financial models. A preliminary analysis of models show that, maybe Mr. Majumdar can also support me there, a rate increase by a percentage point skews your DSCR by maybe a 5 bips sort of a number, which actually creates a lot of uncertainty in lenders' minds whether further funding to those particular projects can be supported or not. So that has been the, and so I feel the projects or the lenders who have taken on board those sort of financing costs for arriving at the viability assumptions will face some issues going forward. That is the.
Thanks, Jayant. I'll request if anybody else on the panel would like to add.
Yeah, no, I have a certain view on this. We've also been part of, as a bank, we've been part of this LOC, LUT kind of a business. Let me just put my viewpoint on this. What was really happening was that, as a developer, you would obviously want to get the cheapest kind of financing. And therefore, developers were accessing this buyer's credit on the back of letters of undertaking from the Indian banks. Now, if you actually look at the difference between the Indian financing which is available to a well-structured good project and the actually hedged cost of this buyer's credit, there was the arbitrage was very, very less. The problem was that here the developers were keeping their foreign currency exposure largely unhedged. If you in the sense that either they would keep it completely open or they would go with some kind of a call spread kind of an option. So they were keeping the foreign currency risk open to a large extent. Now, with the hope that you know the currency will not move against them, and at the end of the day, the overall financing cost is going to be low. Now, here is a problem, because when you're getting into this kind of a financing, then the banks are taking this kind of a risk, which could dramatically affect the project economics, and especially now when the tariffs are actually so low. So in a way, if this product has been withdrawn from the market, I don't see that as too much of a negative. And this is a personal view. The second important thing is that every time we have the situation of buyer's credit, developers have been pushing the envelope. It started off with 50 or 60% and it has gone up to a wish list of 75-80% of the project cost. Now, let me tell you one thing, that every time a bank underwrites the entire project financing, it is a nightmare in terms of downselling that risk to co-participants, because generally banks, nobody wants to you know, finance a project where bulk of the facilities are all going to be non-fund based. So there was a huge dissonance on that account. The third problem that we were facing, which the RBI has tried to correct, is that while the banks would open letters of undertaking, they would get letters of comfort from co-participants on the back. But there's no standard format of a letter of comfort. And that opens a whole lot of questions in terms of if the project were to suffer any kind of a problem, you could have a bank like HDFC opening a letter of undertaking on the hope that a financial institution is sitting at the back with a letter of comfort who just backs out at the last minute. So in a way, I don't think that that's going to upset the overall thing. But yes, the developers would need to factor in more realistic assumptions on the cost of financing when they set up these kind of projects.
Anybody else, if they would like to add to this? We'll make a question for you as a follow-up. So, you know, based on some of these recent developments, are you expecting that for the fresh bids, the tariffs could, you know, see some bit of an increase to factor for all these assumptions?
I would think that the tariff should go to a little bit more reasonable levels. Intuitively, I would feel that's the way it should happen. But having said that, you know, the couple of things which I mentioned earlier also, I think banks need to be convinced about the viability of these tariffs. That's something which I personally believe. This 2 rupee 40 paisa kind of a tariff that is increasingly being the new norm, I think factored in a lot of aggressive assumptions. Now, one of the aggressive assumptions which everybody would agree was that the module prices are going to come down. That's not really happened. And the second was that there was a lot of aggression which was built up in terms of the financing cost. The fact of the matter is that today, none of those assumptions actually stand true. First, the cost of financing has gone up significantly. Between September last year and now, I see 110 basis point increase in the GSEC yields. The bank financing MCLRs have gone up. Second is that the number of banks itself has gone down in terms of number of players who are willing to provide that financing. So the lot of things are right now not in favor of developers. So I think intuitively I would feel that the tariff should come to a level which is more sustainable. But at the same time, somewhere down the line, I believe that that's not going to happen, because there seems to be a mad rush in terms of grabbing projects in the hope of showing large capacities and then flipping those projects over. So I think somewhere down the line, if it settles down, it's going to be good for the industry.